I'll look to my right. Any questions? To my left, Councilmember McShane.
What's leisure activities? Somebody calling and just asking what movie's good or what to do this weekend or what's...
Well, you know, one might think that, but it tends to be more questions about I'd like to join a soccer league or my child needs to have some physical activity. Can you tell me if there's a public park nearby or a place where they can get into t-ball or something like that? It tends to be a little bit more meaty and community-oriented, human and health service-oriented than it is just what time does the, you know, the artist start over at the Osseo Cinemas?
You mean Maya?
I mean the Maya Cinemas.
Yes, right.
Is it playing
just,
there?
Just check it. All right.
You mean Northridge Cinemas.
I know you've got...
Oh, dear.
I know you've got a county to worry about. We got a city.
Well, thank goodness you're doing a very good job of worrying about it and caring
it's
for it.
It's a team sport around here. All right. Anyone else from the council? Councilmember Sanchez.
Hi, Mary.
Hi.
Just wondering how much work are you doing with cities and other public agencies in regards to directing some of that traffic to them? I know some cities have a 411, and just wondering how much of a transition are we making there? Was there any plans to actually move to a integrated 411 where people can call to the additional service you have, but connecting them to city services and county services?
We really haven't taken a look at that. I know that we are more engaged with the disaster side of things than we have been with other modes of communication. And I know that 511 is a number that's going to begin as well, which is the transportation oriented program. It's the sort of thing that I think we would be very interested in looking at. The chair of our 2-1-1 steering committee is known to many of you. It's former Chief Daniel Ortega. And I'll mention your comment to him to see if there's a way that we could reach out to some of the other entities so that there could be more back and forth. I think it's an important thing for us to be able to do.
It just seems like it's a natural next level to go to, because some cities are integrating some of that 411 and 211 and even the 511 to people can actually call one number, and then it becomes the source of all kinds of information, including connecting them to public agencies and services. So
I think that's a great idea.
Interesting to see that, yeah.
We do have example that some of the county departments are in, and if you have city programs, I would expect that they're in the 211 database as well, because it's not just limited to nonprofit organizations. We also include other services within. So I think that it would be important for us to ensure that there is that referral back and forth.
And just in regards to the age of persons needing service, is that the person actually making the call or who the service or the referral is for?
That's a really good question to ask. And we have just changed our provider from one type of database to another type. And now we'll be able to ascertain the answer to your question. We will be able to find out whether or not they're calling for someone or whether they're simply calling themselves. So unfortunately, I don't have the answer to that, but we will be able to track that in the future.
So are we able to ask them, because I'm sure there's a lot of young people making phone calls for parents.
Mm-hmm.
So are they asking them what age you are, and are you tracking that, or is that something for the future or something that you don't ask?
Well, at this point, we do ask questions like that.
Okay.
You know, can you just tell us your age? We're conscious of not probing too deeply because we don't want to turn the caller off.
Sure.
So it's, we're conscious of the kinds of questions that we do ask. In the past, we didn't have a slot, so to speak, to put the answer of, are you calling on behalf of someone? But with this new system that we have, now we've got a little slot to plug that in, so we'll be able to have that data when we come back next year.
Yeah. Do you see any numbers of you track in regards to homelessness or services for young people that are between ages 15 and 20 something? Are you seeing some of that?
Well, you know, I don't have the data pulled out that tracks that, at least not with me, that tracks that specifically. But I know that we have been looking very closely in other different programs that United Way works on to find out what we can do. What are some of the emerging needs that people have in that age group, particularly transitional youth?
And just last question, are you able to track like time when people are actually calling, and they're calling during business hours, or they're calling in the middle of the night, or, you know, be able to track when the majority of those calls or the peak of those calls are coming?
We are able to track that, and most of the calls do come in during the day. Okay. But one of the reasons that that happens is that there are clients who are at nonprofit organization offices, as an example.
I see.
And so people are calling. I can tell you something that has come up this year for the first time that I thought was really interesting. Is as we go out and do our United Way campaign, we're going to a lot of different branches of banks. And the people have been telling me that the people who work in the banks are telling me that they get people who come into them with in such dire circumstances that the people in the banks themselves have been calling 211 to help the client that's standing there in front of them. So while I'm happy that people are using the service, but it's another indication of the severity of the need in our community.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Jill, did you have a question?
Just a quick question. Vanessa and I were sitting here looking at the call volume, and we were curious if you could explain it. So that the calls 2211 increased by 43% in 2011, but it looks like over the period of 2011 they decreased, but I'm sure that we're probably not reading it right. So
I can tell you that the calls did not decrease, and I'm not clear at which part you're looking at.
It's actually the third slide in.
I know that one of the questions that has come up is the ability to track by specific areas. So if you were looking at the call volume slide.
Right.
I don't see how you're seeing that the call volume went down from the previous year.
Oh, from the previous year. We were looking over the period of time. So from January to December.
No, I know that the numbers of calls that we track definitely increased.
Okay. Did that answer the question? Thanks.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Mary.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you. We'll.
I'll leave these with you for distribution if you should choose.
Good. Go ahead and do that, and we'll. Is there any public comment on 211? Okay. Back to council. Any final comments?
There.
Yes, Sergio.
Mary, I just want to thank you and United Way's work on this 211. When we launched the first phone call, that I actually used my mother as an example, and it was not an example, it was a reality that she needed some services. And just being able to connect it with the transit and just using the technology, I think that was pretty amazing to see. But looking at this report, and I appreciate you coming back, a lot of the organizations come and tell us about something, and we don't necessarily hear about them. But thank you for bringing us back some information and hearing some of the feedback. But definitely look forward to the continuing work and great work of 211, but really looking at the next level of it is using technology, maybe an app or something that young people can use, and some of the other folks that are more techie. I know Councilmember McShane likes that. So figuring out how to integrate technology, because a lot of people are looking at that, and but definitely moving to the next level, which is connecting public agencies and you know other organizations, so they can continue to provide additional resources. But you're doing a great job, and I think that is so great when the whole United Way started moving forward to establishing 211. I thought it was really great, and obviously there's a great usage of it. So really appreciate it. The 174 languages, I mean, what can you say about that? That is just amazing, and just wonder what the 20% of unknown and what those languages were. But and imagine there's tons of, it is a melting pot, and there's a lot of diverse communities. So really appreciate the work of United Way and yourself and taking this leadership. I think it's a great program.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate the kind words. Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else from council? Mary, always wonderful to see you.
Thanks so much.
Maya or Northridge, next time you want to go to the movies, okay? All right.
Thank you very much.
All right. We are going to welcome back a familiar face, Marina. Welcome back to the city. We're all delighted to see you back home. And we're going to talk about a police chief.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Council members. I'm presenting, giving you a brief presentation on the status of the police chief recruitment. For the past 3 weeks, the Human Resources Department has been working with the firm of Bob Murray and Associates on the city manager's recruitment for the next police chief. Bob Murray and Associates is a firm that specializes in executive recruitment and has years of experience recruiting local government professionals. Bob Murray is familiar with the city of Salinas, our community, the challenges we face, as he has previously assisted in recruitments for city managers, fire chief, city attorney, and the economic development director. I've provided the council with a draft of the brochure that we've put together over the last few days. However, prior to finalizing, we would like to share with you, members of the police department and the community, the public that we serve, with an opportunity to look at the what we've put together and comment. And we invite any input with regard to the characteristics and or qualities that you would like to see in our next police chief, as well as any input with regard to the recruitment process, which I will cover briefly. That being stated, we may not be able to incorporate all suggestions into the brochure or the recruitment process. We will, however, take into consideration any feedback and try and incorporate wherever possible the suggestions and ideas into the brochure or interview and selection process. I will briefly walk you through the brochure that we've put together. And as you flip over to page two, the brochure details the community, the organization, position, and compensation. At page two, we cover the community and industry of the Salinas Valley. We cover some of the largest employers in Salinas and some of the annual attractions. We cover city government, the police department, its personnel, and the operating divisions within the department. Moving right along, at page three, we cover some of the characteristics that we are looking for in our police chief, such as leadership traits, team building, motivation, collaboration, in working with the department, the organization, and the community. Among other characteristics, as noted in the PowerPoint, this is not a comprehensive list and is exactly why we're inviting for your input and that of the community. The timeline for the recruitment is noted in the PowerPoint. I'll briefly discuss the activities. Bob Murray and Associates will be responsible for placing ads with professional journals such as Western Cities, Jobs Available, Careers in Government, California Police Chiefs Association, and the International Association of Chiefs of Police, among others. Next week, the week of February 13, we hope to finalize the brochure and send to the printer the week of February 21. The recruitment process will close the week of March 19, specifically March 23. Following the closing date for the recruitment, Bob Murray will screen resumes and, based on the criteria established with the city manager, will attempt to narrow the field of candidates. Preliminary interviews are scheduled for the week of April 12th and usually entail interviews by Bob Murray of 10 to 12 candidates, with the goal of determining which candidates have the greatest potential to succeed in our organization, as well as looking into the motivation for applying for the position and assessment of their knowledge, skills, and ability for the position. The week of April 9, Bob Murray will meet with the city manager to discuss his recommendations for a limited number of candidates based on the information gathered through his preliminary interviews. Final interviews are scheduled for the week of April 16 with the city manager. This will most likely include panel interviews with some community involvement. The week of April 23rd through May 4th has been designated for thorough background checks, which will entail credit, criminal, and civil litigation, among other things, as well as detailed confidential reference checks. As you can see, the recruitment process takes several weeks of work. The process is now in motion. We're excited to be working with the city manager and the firm of Bill Murray and Associates as we move to hire our next police chief. And we invite your input.
Okay, any questions by council? Let's see, Councilmember Barrera.
Ms. Gallegos, thank you very much for your report, and it's good to have you back in the city of Salinas. Ms. Gallegos, one of the critical things as one of the seven up here, my biggest concern is the community involvement. You mentioned some of the panelists will also be part of the community. Who gets, does the community also have this brochure that you just gave us?
No, it's in draft form and hasn't been released to the public.
Will the public, with enough time, will the public have access to this?
Yes.
My other question is, who gets to select those community panelists?
This is a city manager recruitment, and the city manager will have input on who those community members will be and a selection process.
Besides the city manager having input, will he be the one selecting this panel?
He may be, yes.
You're not sure?
No.
Can I ask the city manager? Because I want to make sure that this is very transparent.
Yes, that's
it's
our
critical.
Goal here.
It's critical. So I'm going to ask this city manager as far as that process.
Sure.
Councilmember Barrera, this actually, it doesn't quite say it, but there are several opportunities for community panels. It is the under the authority of the city manager that the selection is made, but as we all know, it's very important to have as much input into the selection process as possible. So the first step here is recruitment. That's opening it up to the public and to anybody else who wants to make a comment and provide some input into the recruitment process, and that starts with the brochure. So no, I would take information, suggestions from each member of the council, and take that in consideration. I'm sure you all have different ideas about how the community panels should be selected and who should be on them.
Well, if I may ask another question, as one of the seven here, I would like you to select the community panel as the city manager, being that you're going to be hiring the police chief. My other concern is, being that there is a timeline, and you've expressed it very well, I just want to make sure that the community does have access to be able to give their input, whether it's, I don't know what email you're going to give, or where they have enough time. But as one of the council members here, my biggest issue is I want the city manager to hire that police chief, but also select the panel without my input, without me. Thank you.
Okay, let's ask Councilmember Craig, then Gloria.
I have three questions. Under the compensation section of this draft form,
yes.
It lists the salary range at 161 to 196 in terms of 100,000 in terms of what the pay scale is. Does that take into account the recent reset in pay,
yes,
that we approved a few weeks ago to,
yes,
address the compaction issues?
Yes.
Excellent. Thank you. And two, just if you could speak to what the process is. I'm not sure, and I just want some clarification on what the process is in selecting the search firm.
The process, typically for executive level positions, city, local government issues RFPs, and we solicit responses from the various recruiting agencies. I was not back at the city working when the selection was made for this firm, so that happened before I started working here, and just as soon as I started, I was advised this is the firm that's been selected to handle the recruitment. But typically it's through an RFP process.
And do you know, or maybe Jim Pia can answer to, did we do an RFP for this process?
Specifically for this recruitment, we did not. We certainly can take under the parameters are such that the city manager can make the determination to select a recruiting firm. There are a handful of the firms. This particular firm was also involved in the fire recruitment, as noted by Marina, and so we felt there was some economy of scale on that. But fully noted on each and every recruitment, executive recruitment, we could do that. So it's a point well taken.
And it's my understanding we have several to choose from. Is that correct?
There's a handful in California. Some are better than others at certain, this is a public safety recruitment, and we believe that this firm is one of the better ones for public safety, but they all have certain specialties. But yes, there are others to choose from.
Okay, and then my final question is, who does the background check, the references?
The firm of Bob Murray and Associates.
Excellent. I'd like to see some community participation in that, or qualified background as well. So background investigation as well. Thank you.
Okay, Gloria.
Marina, I like this. I like the brochure. For me, it would be very important that the selection group, and to the city manager, that it's a diversified group. Okay, and also I was reading this because we just received it, but for me it's very important community policing, that chief community policing has, for me it's very important, and okay. I think for the rest of the community, because we want community policing, so that's important.
Okay,
and let's see, not to forget that we also have a police advisory board.
Okay. Over here? These are questions. Yes, yeah, these are just strictly questions. Okay, any public comment?
Ray DeLo, 150 Kern Street. I've taken the opportunity to speak with several of the officers around town. They may not say it, but they don't want somebody who's gonna be here for 2 years and retire. And as I look at what it's going to cost us to do the search, I don't want somebody's going to be here for 2 weeks and or 2 months and 2 years or whatever and retire. So I'm hoping that we're looking at somebody in the 40 to 50 year range, not somebody who's 60 and getting ready to retire. I know you can't be discriminating on age, but I'm sure you can find somebody out there that will meet that. That's what your troops are looking for. Also, the officers are looking for somebody that is in that age range and knows how to run a computer and knows how to run all the technology and those things. So I would hope that that would be taken under consideration. And I really do hope and pray that we do not start somebody out at the top of the scale. We do not have the money. 161 sounds pretty good to me.
Okay. Thank you, Ray. Anyone else from the public?
Name is Eric Peterson, and just a thought that might be considered and would take cooperation of everybody involved to do, but to steal a page from what Monterey just did, where they had two deputy police chiefs and they promoted one to chief and made the other assistant chief, which would of course be, had the current deputy chiefs would have a lot to say in that because they both have to say yes. But we do have two good deputy chiefs now, and there's no reason why we can't. It would benefit the community in a number of ways if we keep them involved. Thank you.
Thanks, Eric. Anyone else from the public? Okay, I'm going to close public comment. Back to council. I'll start to my left. Councilmember Sanchez.
Mayor, thank you. Just a few recommendations for the brochure. And just beginning with the pictures, I think we should choose pictures of landmarks of Salinas to be an attraction versus, you know, police vehicles in action out there. I think we have better pictures in our community, so we should put that as a more of an attraction versus I really don't like the pictures. The other one, I appreciate the history on how Salinas was was founded and how it was after Mexico succeeded from Spain. I think that's great history. I think it also needs to include the demographic makeup of our community. I think that's really important, so a candidate knows what makes up our city. In regards to the page number two, like the kids, but maybe if we can find a better, more appropriate picture for it. But just on the ideal candidate, I think I definitely agree with Councilmember De La Rosa in regards to community policing. I think that's where we're moving to, and we need to have someone that has experience implementing and developing a program like that. If they don't have the experience, I really don't want them to spend the time here learning it. Mm-hmm. In regards to their experience on working in diverse communities, we have gotten some applicants where the population does not, where they worked before, does not reflect anywhere where Salinas is at. And just having that experience and working in diverse communities, I think that's important to add. And just in regards to the panel, I wanna insist, and hopefully my colleagues can agree. One is I would like to see this council recommend at least one or two people each to the city manager for consideration. We understand that is one of his jobs and one of his responsibilities, unlike the selection of a city manager, where it's totally the city council's decision and doesn't necessarily provide for public, that kind of a public panel. But that's what we did when we hired this last police chief. The city manager took our recommendations, and he, I think, majority appointed most of the people. So it was a great, diverse panel of the community. Ultimately, he made the decision. We made a recommendation, and he made a decision. I think that panel should also include council members, up to your choice also. But one of the things I'm also going to insist is that we have youth and young adults involved in it. Every single panel that I've seen is old fogies like me, and so we need to have, from the youth perspective, a young person that is high school level and a young adult that is between the ages of 18 and 25. I think it's important to hear from them and what they want to see on a police chief, because unfortunately, that is where we're having issues with in some of those young people in our community that don't necessarily get it all the time. So I think it'd be good to hear from the young people. So definitely want you to consider all that. We know, and I respect your responsibility and authority to select as chief, but I think that would make for a better panel. You are new to this part of the community of Salinas, but I think we can help you in selecting good people that can give you good advice. So those are my recommendations, but I'm excited that we're moving to fill this pretty important, necessary position of our city.
Thank you, Sergio. Councilmember McShane.
Two things. One is Councilwoman De La Rosa said, with the PCAC out there, we should utilize them in any way possible. Two, it's the city manager's role to make this hire, not ours. And I'm sure he will take our suggestions and the suggestions of a very vocal and interested community. Neighborhoods being a big part of it, I think that's an opportunity right there. Maybe one last thing. How about a web page or a page available through our city page? The more information we can put out there for the candidates that are going to actually read through and read up on our city, and we make it easy for them, the better off. There was some terrific work done by Chief Featheroff, internal studies, the post study. I think it is important to give as clear a picture as possible as to our community, the diversity, some of our struggles, and where we're at, so that whoever it is that comes forward interviews strong and well-prepared and is ready to get to work, because this is a city that faces big challenges.
Thank you, Steve. Okay. Jill, anything? To my right, Councilmember Craig.
Just a few points. One, I know that it has been noted, and I certainly recognize that our city manager makes that appointment, but a tendency to lean towards experience over age. I would really like to give strong direction. I think that we are earning a reputation as a retirement city in terms of some of our hiring of top management. I would really like to see a younger, I would like to have, I would like to have a police chief for at least a decade. I mean, in terms of long-term planning, in terms of what we're trying to accomplish in fighting, you know, the issues that we face with our gang problems, I would like somebody here who can plan long-term. And so that's my personal opinion. And then I guess speaking to my questions earlier, in terms of the search process, I really would like to see an RFP go out for a search firm. I think that there are many opportunities and people are hungry for business. I'd like to be able to see several search firms apply for that position. And then lastly, the background investigation, I would like to see our police department actually participate in that background investigation of the soon-to-be police chief. I think that it's important, while I recognize that it's the job of the consulting firm to bring forward candidates, background investigation should be left to the professionals. So